Thank you very much. I consider myself as a privilege to be here as part of the member of the IMA Kodapakkam to address this gallery. So I would like to next 10-15 minutes, I will talk to you about something very important advances which have taken place in the last 2 years. Next. Change in the approach as an intervention cardiologist. Now we have so much evidence and science is advanced, so we are basing everything based on these. I think as a physician, medical practitioner, it's very important for you all to know the basic changes in imaging and physiology which we are now routinely doing in the cath lab. One of the important tests is called fractional flow reserve, which is again a pressure-based method to know whether a lesion is physiologically significant or not. For example, whatever we assess, plots say 70%, 80% is all visual assessment, which can sometimes vary between person to person. FFR is a physiology where we measure the pressure. Next slide. We measure the pressure. PA is aortic pressure, PD is distal coronary pressure. So we can accurately measure the, basically it's a ratio of pressures. So if you look at the pressure of the aorta divided by the pressure distally, if aortic pressure is 1, the distal pressure should be at least 0.8. Next slide. So basically the cutoff value is 0.8. Anything which is above 0.8, that lesion is not physiologically significant and need not be stented or grafted with bypass surgery. Whereas if the pressure FFR is less than 0.8, it is quite significant. The cutoff value of 0.75 is even more significant. Between 0.7 and 0.5 is a borderline area, but anything less than 0.8 we consider as highly significant. So today the data is so high that it's been now recommended as class 1 indication to assess intermediate lesions with a level of evidence A. Both American College of Cardiology and the European Heart Association guidelines recommend FFR as a class 1 indication when you have a doubt or to assess whether stenting is required or not. For example, a 72-year-old lady she was diagnosed. She was diagnosed with coronary artery disease. She was advised bypass surgery. And when she came to us, she found to have borderline lesions in all three vessels. The borderline lesion, the circumflex artery, multiple borderline lesions, the right coronary artery. They're all not tight, so we decided to do a multi-vessel FFR. Next slide. So, next please. Keep going fast. This is all FFR. Next slide, I'll show you. Next please. Can you move next?
Next slide, Pa.
So, when you want to do an FFR, we can assess the pressure. So basically there are two red and green bars of overlap. So here the pressure is 0.92, which means the pressure difference is only 0.92. As I told you, anything above 0.8 can be slightly left for medical management. So all the vessels 1.92, 0.97. Clearly they're all not significant. And this lady was put on medical management and advised only plain medical management. Next slide. And she did extremely well. Asymptomatic, FFR not significant. So they do very well. So it's very important to use this whenever required. Next slide. So then other important advances, imaging. Now, 40% of my interventions are now totally imaging based, which means there are two types of imaging which we do. This is intra-hospital ultrasound, nothing but a small probe which can be taken to the coronary artery, and we can have quickly run in 5-10 minutes. We get a huge amount of information. We know the vessel size, we know the disease where we can land the stent proximally, distally, the landing zone. We can measure the length of the vessel, the exact size of the stent. So when we do these precise measurements, it clearly gives us a better result, both acutely and it also translates to excellent long-term results. So this has been documented with huge evidence, and today many of the main procedures like left main stenting have huge data, which is always the long-term results are much better when we use intravascular ultrasound guided angioplasty. Next slide. Also another important imaging, which is called the optical coherence tomography or OCT. Which is again started in the field of ophthalmology, but now it's moved to interventional cardiology, where the ultrasound, you know, is a sound-based imaging, where we use ultrasound. Here, this is an infrared light-based imaging, OCT. So basically, we use infrared light, and one problem with OCT is the light does not penetrate the blood. So we cannot visualize the coronary artery because it's always blood is inside. So what we have to do is we have to remove the blood and image. It's not possible practically. So what we do is we inject contrast, and that for a few seconds we can get an image when the contrast is injected to the blood vessel. So when so blood has been cleared to do an imaging. So this is a imaging, and this has got a very high resolution, which is the resolution is higher than the electron microscopy. We can see the three layers of the vessel wall. You can see the outer bright layer, the intima, the mid dark layer, the media, and the outer bright layer in adventitia. So intima, media, adventitia, all are clearly seen. This vessel is healthy, normal vessel, pre-layered appearance. So the resolution is so high that one can clearly identify what the pathology is. So I can look at the lesion is thrombus, the lesion is my calcium, then I can use aggressive vasodilatation. If there's a soft clock or a lipid containing clock, then I use they can go distal embolization, so I can do a gentle giant dilatation. So it gives a tremendous amount of advantage, but the only downside of it is it's usually high resolution. So if we don't react to even small things. We see the stent, which is even enlarged to 500 times. So it's very high resolution and sensitivity. We use this routinely, and in fact, we are one of the highest volume imaging operation in the country. Next slide. Next interesting case: a 64-year-old lady, diabetic, recent anterior wall MI. Next slide. So we have a patient who has a borderline-looking lesion in the right coronary artery. If you look at the lesion, it appears to be only about 50 or 60%. So is this significant? It doesn't appear significant, at least visually. What should be done? Generally, these lesions, when somebody sees, are left with medical management thinking it's only 50%. But we have a 50-60% lesion, we always routinely measure physiology. The first step, next slide. So when we measure FFR, the value is 0.53, which is less than 0.8. Highly significant. Very surprising. The borderline lesion is appearing only 50% by angiogram, having an FFR of 0.53. Very unusual. What is the reason? So we want to do imaging to see what's happening inside. Next slide. So we go inside, we see that we do a pullback, and we see the 0.5 FFR here, 0.5 FFR here. It comes to 1 here, suddenly jump. So clearly there is some pathology here which we are not seeing by coronary angiogram. Next slide. So we do an angiogram, we see multiple recanalized channels like this. There are varying shapes of varying channels. Clearly the contrast or dye what we give during angiography has passed through these channels, and it doesn't appear significant when we do an angiogram. Whereas in imaging we now clearly see it's nothing but a recanalized thrombus. When a person has got 100% occlusion and a heart attack, the artery recanalizes at varying degrees, and you see multiple channels like this, and this can often be missed when you use only angiography. So if you use these techniques like pressure measurement and imaging, we now clearly know that what is the pathology, whether we need to stent or leave it in medical management. Next slide. Next slide. So this patient had a significant FFR, was managed with 2 stents. Next slide. So, and we got a great result. This is again, an OCT will also help us to assess after stenting. We will know whether the stent is opposed to the vessel wall, whether there is any edge dissection, whether the stent is rightly sized. So clearly, it gives superior results when we use imaging. Next slide. So the next important advance in the interventional cardiology, which I'm going to talk to you for the next 5 minutes, is transcatheter aortic valve replacement, which is nothing but conventional aortic stenosis. Has been conventional treatment for severe aortic stenosis has been surgical aortic valve replacement. Recently, we have started doing catheter-based interventions. It's for structural heart disease. We started with aortic stenosis. We're also moving to mitral valve and also tricuspid valve. We're also doing pulmonary valve. So slowly we are moving to more and more catheter-based structural interventions, and the role of the surgeon will eventually slowly come down. Next slide. So the conventional treatment of a symptomatic severe aortic stenosis has been surgical aortic valve replacement. But many of them, due to multiple risk factors, may not be able to undergo open surgery with general anesthesia. Next slide. So the new alternative is transcatheter aortic valve replacement. It was first performed by Professor Alain Privier in France. Next slide. Next slide. So this is Professor Alain Privier, previous slide. So this is Professor Alain Privier. This was first in man transcatheter aortic valve replacement was done in 2002 in France. Next slide. I was fortunate to work with Professor Privier for some short period of time. Next slide. Next slide. So this is an animation which will make you understand how it is being done. So this is a stenotic aortic valve. You can see the valve is not fully open. The aortic valve is between the left ventricle aorta, which pumps blood into the rest of the body. We normally use the femoral artery. Femoral artery is a big sized artery through which we pass a wire which we go through the aorta. Retrogradely from the aorta, we cross the aortic valve,
stenotic valve valve into the left ventricle, and then we do a balloon dilatation to just redirect the valve to make sure the valve is open. Then we use a this is a valve which we take in, and then we deploy. So this is actually a balloon dilatation where we use a balloon to open the valve. This is done with rapid pacing. We have to pace the heart at 200 beats per minute, with, during which time the cardiac output is reduced to reduced significantly, and otherwise the balloon will be ejected out. So we reduce the cardiac output by rapid pacing, and then we take do a balloon dilatation, and then we do the this is a valve which is mounted on a stent. So there are two types of valve. For a short of time, I'm just going to tell you very briefly. This is a stent which has got the valve inside. So the valve, the stent, when the stent is deployed, the valve starts functioning. So the stent, the valve is over the balloon. The balloon is inflated. The valve stent is in place. Within the stent, there is a valve. And due to the pressure difference between the aorta and the left ventricle, the new valve starts working immediately. And you could see that. Now I can show you a short axis of the valve. The valve instantly functions. And significantly, the stenosis disappears and the pressure becomes normal. Now you can see the valve which is fully opening and closing the new valve. So basically, this is an animation. And now, today, till now, we have done around 20 patients with like this. And these patients have done well. Dr. Pasadi will be able to share. One of these patients, we were able to do a patient who was highly symptomatic, who was high risk, he had COPD, and he was denied surgical aortic valve replacement, he had no other option. And fortunately, this person hugely benefited. We did a transcatheter aortic valve replacement with a Medtronic core valve. And this patient hugely benefited. Now he is fully ambulant, he is not able to lie down, he was on oxygen. He was continuously lying down on bed, he was suffering. And fortunately, thanks to these new advances, he is now able to do all his routine activities by himself after the TAVR. So next slide. So I'll just show you one example. This is one of our very high-risk patients. This is a 90-year-old diabetic, hypertensive, bypass surgery done earlier. Diagnosed to have severe aortic stenosis since 2013, moderate and started as moderate, progressively increased. He had recurrent hospital admissions for heart failure. Echocardiogram showed severe LV dysfunction with severe aortic stenosis. The problem is once the aortic stenosis is long-standing, they start developing LV dysfunction, which is again progressive. And he had a chronic kidney disease with the eGFR of 20 mL per minute. He also had pleural effusion. He had prohibitively high risk for surgical intervention. The mortality, predicted mortality was more than 20%. He was on bed. He was actually related to the former chief minister, another, right? And he was not able to lie down from the bed. Severely gasping for breath. He had no option. In fact, he was waiting for his death because the surgeons refused any surgery because he was at very high risk. He had surgery, CABG, multiple problems. So, with that, next slide. He was a thin and fragile person. Next slide. Yeah, so we did a CT evaluation. Next slide. And we did a transcatheter aortic valve replacement during the procedure. He had a brief cardiac arrest. He could not tolerate the rapid pacing, but fortunately, after the valve is placed, he's immediately his hemodynamics improved. He started having normal beats and ejection fraction from 30% improved to 50%. Next slide. So this is the valve in place. He was weaned off the ventilator and no ECG changes. And now it's almost, this is an old slide, he's almost completed 1 year. He celebrated his 92nd birthday with me and he's doing extremely well. Next slide. This man is now walking. He's walking to my outpatient department. So this is the message I would like to give today. There is a huge change in the approach to structural heart disease, and now there's a big role for interventional cardiology where we use catheter-based interventions to treat severe aortic stenosis. And to conclude, newer imaging modalities, physiological methods, FFR, next slide, all these are the new changing trends for coronary artery stenting and transcatheter aortic valve replacement. Though it started with for inoperable cases, moved to high-risk cases, today we are also doing for intermediate-risk patients, but I'm very sure in the near future, in the next 2 years, you will also do low-risk cases for surgery. In fact, the entire surgical aortic valve replacement will be changed to transcatheter valve replacement. So it's currently now a guideline endorsed. Today, it has got a class 1 recommendation for high and intermediate risk for transcatheter aortic valve replacement. And in our program has been very strong. And also, I'm happy to share with you, we have now started a study of the Indian valve. 3 days ago, we did the first Indian valve, which is totally made in India from a company called Medal Life Sciences. And this we have started, we have, after ethical committee clearance, we have started the first in-man trial, and we already enrolled one patient with the Indian valve called the MyValve, and this patient did extremely well under procedure, and we are waiting for a 30 patient trial after which valve will be available commercially in the country. Thank you for your patience.
What happens to the native valve?
So it's like a stent. What happens to the block after a stent? The blood is crushed across the block is crushed across the vessel. Like when you stamp on the wet sand, the beach, how it is when you walk. It's similar to that. When the valve is crushed by the stent, the valve is crushed by the stent and plastered to the sides. So the new valve which is within the stent starts working. So the only one fear is one of the drastic complications can happen is the old valve. When if it is very thick and calcific, it can go and obstruct the coronary arteries which are very close to the aortic valve. That is why we always do a careful CT and look at the measurements, what is the height of the coronary artery. And we have to be extremely careful with our low-lying coronaries. We have to protect the coronary artery and be prepared to stent if it suddenly occurs. So that is one of the major problems we can face sometimes.
Can it be dislodged? Can it get displaced once you install the valve? Can it get displaced?
Yeah. See, that is why most of these. Very good question. The reason that the whole idea of using this valve is to anchor the calcium. The aortic stenosis very often or always inevitably have calcium. That is why in non-calcific rheumatic aortic stenosis we cannot use this valve. As you say, there is a risk of embolization because the valve can't hold without any. We are not suturing the valve. So always invariably these patients invariably have calcium. So even mild calcium helps to anchor the valve, because calcium really helps to anchor the valve. The stent struts are holding come, it's held by the calcium.
Is there any age criteria?
Sir, the problem with this procedure is relatively new. It's only available for the last 10 years abroad and available in our country for the last 2 years. So, it's only available for patients who are really denied surgery, with high risk for open surgery. Then it moved to intermediate risk patients. So most of these patients are elderly, often above 70 years, 80 years, 90 years. But in the near future, it will move to low-risk patients, younger patients as well. But it will take time. We don't have yet data for younger patients. Sir, I would like to share a little bit of experience what we had, if you can share.
No. Not this. In this particular case, Dr. Sengupen mentioned, this patient was denied a surgery in 2013 in the same hospital. The surgeon said it's too high risk to undertake this aortic valve procedure for this gentleman. But luckily, in 2017 he could get this done and is very happy. This particular patient is almost about 78. He's a well qualified man. He did very well. Dr. Zengel, I want to find out whether angiogram, should they not mention the FFR in each and every case, or does it take much longer time to get it done?
So the FFR actually, it takes only, for experienced operators, it takes only additional 5 minutes. But the only issue is, if the lesion is 90%, then we don't need it for very likely, then for the significant. When you have a borderline lesion, or there's a doubt whether it's significant or not, definitely FFR will have a value. Because FFR not only takes into the severity of the lesion, it also takes into account the amount of myocardium supplied by the vessel. If the 90% lesion is a small area of supply, FFR will be negative. You don't have to do anything. If it is only a 70% lesion but supplies a large area of myocardium, then FFR may be significant and needs stenting.
Is there a guidelines for that to do that? If
FFR,
it is below 90 and doubtful.
Yes.
Today,
it's one of the guidelines that has the highest level of scientific evidence, with level of evidence A, the class 1 indication. In patients of borderline lesions, both European Society and American College.
But are we following terminally or in
the unfortunately, the penetration is slow due to various reasons, but today the awareness is increasing. We have been using for the last 4 or 5 years, and we have also published Indian AVO1 data, and it's actually increasing now. Also now, with a lot of people cry about stents, new evidence, we are using appropriateness criteria where we don't use unnecessary stents. More and more the usage is coming up.
How much is the cost?
The cost 30,000.
You have talked of the advanced in physiology, you have talked of the advanced structure, additional ultrasound over the
So
Is there any advances in microcirculation onto the myocyte, either by radio nuclear studies or any other advances which are being? Finally, what matters is the microcirculation to the myocyte?
Excellent, sir. Very nice question. As particularly in acute coronary syndrome like after ST elevation MI, what is more important is the microcirculation than an epicardial blood vessel. Because we open the vessel, the vessel looks nice, 90%, 100% block, we remove it. But the problem is the thrombus undergoes distal embolization, minute particles go down, obstruct the microcirculation. Whatever you open the vessel, the myocardium, there's no benefit to the myocardium. That's a very valid question. So particularly in ST elevation or acute coronary syndrome, in chronic lesions it doesn't matter. Because in ST elevation, the thrombi can easily get into the microcirculation. So today there are something like catheters which we can treat the microcirculation, where the catheter, for example, there is something called a clear way catheter, which can be taken into the blood vessel, into the site of block, up to the near the microcirculation, and we can inject medications. So that way the concentration of the drug can be increased 500 times more in microcirculation than when you give IV. Or even when you give it the coronary artery, 50% of them will go to unwanted branches. So you can go and target the microcirculation and treat. By doing that, we improve the circulation of the microcirculation and thereby we improve the myocardial function in a more effective way. So it has got a value particularly in acute coronary syndrome and ST elevation in mind.
When you have more than one block, then you do it only one and do the other one later?
Again, it is generally, today, in acute coronary syndrome, the data saying that if we have to attend to the infarct related artery or the artery which is causing the problem first, followed by the other vessels also in the same sitting. Earlier there was a debate, today we can treat at the same time if the two blocks are if it is significant. If it is not significant, we can do FFR if it is doubtful and leave it also with medical medicine.
The aortic group is
dilated,
you are not doing anything for the aortic group.
So, as you said, the problems with the valve therapy is in infancy, particularly in our country. So, currently it is only being approved for use in aortic stenosis. In aortic regurgitation lesion, where the roots are usually dilated, and also the question was asked about calcium, there is no calcium, and the root is dilated, then we have some challenges because the valve can embolize. So we will have to make sure the root is not hugely dilated. So again, it is very critical to do a CT scan of the aortic valve and do very proper accurate measurements and then decide whether the transcatheter valve is suitable or not. As I am speaking, I just got a call of a patient from Palakkad with critical aortic stenosis and she was in permanent edema from CCO. They are just shifted, they are shifting in ambulance. Just now they have reached, so I am going to go straight to the hospital to see the patient who is critically stenosed in pulmonary edema. So these are the patients who are really beneficial to this therapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Secretary. Next, we move on to the journey of Baroda Trophy.
Please.